Some of the research questions in your research project will be knowledge questions. Now remember, knowledge questions ask how the real world is. So what phenomena exist, how are they produced, what properties they have, and so on. And there are two kinds of knowledge questions that you can ask about them. Descriptive knowledge questions and explanatory knowledge questions. I will discuss explanatory questions in a moment, so let's first look at descriptive knowledge questions. Now, they are factual questions. They are the empirical questions that journalists and detectives should ask. And they are not opinions. They should be facts. They should describe facts. Now, an opinion would be an interpretation of an event, of a fact. For example, whether it is a good or a bad thing. And maybe it would be a sort of inconclusive hypothesis about what probably happened, even if you didn't see it. An opinion would be an inconclusive statement about which there is still can be some discussion. You fill in the blanks. And the answer to a descriptive question should not be an opinion, but a fact. Very important, because nowadays on the social media, the distinction between opinions and facts seems to have been forgotten. And some of the, let's say, very powerful presidents in the world also are totally uninterested in this distinction between facts and opinions. In design, where things really have to work, it is important. And the questions that we ask when we want to describe the world are the journalistic, famous journalistic questions like what happened, when did it happen, where did it happen, who was involved, how did it happen, and if there's a quantity involved, how much of it, if there are people or other entities involved, how many of them, how much space did it take, how fast did it happen, and any other question about a variable of interest. And the answers will be evaluated on truth. They will not be evaluated on whether I like it or not that it happened. They will be evaluated on truth, supported by observations, or more dignified, supported by measurements. Now, this is important, not only in the design science, but in other places as well. But we are talking here about design science. So it's important because if you and I don't agree on facts, on the facts of your problem, then I cannot solve your problem. It's the same way if you go to the doctor and you describe your symptoms and he or she hears something different, so you have a different perception of what the problem actually is, well then the doctor cannot solve your problem. So for problem solving, you have to have a shared perception of the problem based on facts, based on observations. And similarly, of course, for solutions. So if I present a solution to you and you and I cannot agree on the performance of this solution, then you will not accept it. So that's, we need the same perception of how the solution performs in your problem context. So in design, we cannot have alternative facts. We can never have alternative facts because this is an incoherent concept. But here it's quite important. Now, this may seem easy, but if you think about, for example, a research topic, how many projects were over budget? So we have to have an unambiguous, clear and objective perception of how many projects there were, what the budget for these projects were, and at the end of the project, whether the project was over budget or not. And some of these things can be a subject of opinion. Some can think, well, actually the project was finished a year ago and then it was on budget. And others can say, no, the project was finished only recently and it's very much over budget. And so we need, in some cases, to make very careful observations in the terms of documents, based on the memory actually of people, to figure out what the facts are. So it's not as easy as it sounds sometimes to figure out what happened, when did it happen, and so on. But it's important to end up with a description of the facts. So to add one metaphor, we have journalists, we have detectives, but we also have judges. Yeah, so if you go to a court of law, the judge will start with establishing the facts of the case in such a way that all the participants in the court case should and will agree on the facts. And then he or she will give a judgment, an opinion. How good was it or how bad was it? But even if there are many different stakeholders with different interests, we should start problem solving with establishing the facts. And if that's not possible, then that is a new fact with which you have to work. Okay, that's descriptive knowledge questions. Then, of course, the second one is the explanatory knowledge question. The answers to that should also be based on evidence and argument, but now we go beyond the facts. We give an explanation of why something happened. And often there can be more than one explanation. There can be alternative explanations. In that case, we order them on plausibility and we support them by evidence and argument. You do this all the time when you are, for example, debugging a piece of software. When it crashes, the first thing you figure out is what are the facts of the case. For which inputs does it crash and is that repeatable? In that case, you are answering a descriptive knowledge question. What is happening? Once you have established what is happening, you try to find an explanation. You think of the components of the software. You think of the way that the input travels through the components and triggers them and what they should do. And you try to isolate the component or the interaction among components where something happens which is not expected. So in that case, you are building a theory that explains the facts. And similarly, a detective collects the data on the crime scene. And then slowly they will be building a theory about what happened and why it happened. So an explanation is based on facts but goes beyond it, and it should be based on evidence and argument. And again, this is important in design, because even if you and I have the same perception of the problem, if I do not understand your problem, then I cannot treat it. This is an important principle of medical reasoning. So if the doctor knows what my symptoms are but doesn't understand them, he doesn't know, or he or she doesn't know, what biological mechanism produced these symptoms, then there is no treatment. Maybe the doctor can give me a painkiller, but not the medicine that would contribute to a healing process. Yes? Without diagnosis, there's no treatment. And also, when I have a solution, I have an artifact design and I give it to you and I say, well, this will have this and this effect. But if I don't understand why the effect is produced in the problem, in a particular problem context, I have no real reason to recommend it to you. Yeah, so I should understand why my solution, why my artifact behaves in the way it does before I can recommend it to you.